Which would... Sorry?
Oh!
Adipus.
Oh no!
There's nothing happening.
I'm so glad I
This is why you check my stream.
Hello! Hello, yes! I press go live. Are we live?
Am I live, Tasha?
I've only been doing this for 8 years. Well, I've only been streaming for a couple of those, but... Yes, hello! Welcome to the stream with me, TapersCrazy. We are back. Well, I say we're back. But the reason why I'm howling with laughter is because I've been talking for the past 5 minutes and I didn't press go live in OBS. So Tasha came in, I was like, you're not live. Well, that's embarrassing. Right, it says I'm live. I can see my face good. Hello, welcome to the stream. Yes, we are playing Persona 4 Arena Ultimax today, since we completed No More Heroes, which was a fantastic game. I love the way that No More Heroes ended. It was so fun and it made me so excited to play No More Heroes 2, but in the grand interest of not getting burnt out by playing one specific franchise, I elected to move on to Persona 4 Arena Ultimax because I was equally as excited to do the continuation of not only the story of Persona 4, but Persona 3 as well. For those of you who don't know, if you've not played Persona 4 or 3, I advise you play it before watching this if you don't want spoilers or anything, because it does delve into a bit about what happened in those games. So cut off now and go play the game or watch another Let's Play bit, which I did a while ago. I've done both those games. But the general summary is in Persona 3, there's a team of people called the Seas. I'm not sure what it stands for. Special something something, basically. Their job is to investigate a phenomenon called the midnight hour, which is a period of time between midnight and I guess 1 o'clock, where a bunch of shadows, which are monsters that embody the personification of human emotion and investigate what's going on there, and they eventually it leads to the world nearly being destroyed, and then see saving the day, with a lot of stuff in between. Persona 4, you play the investigation team, which is a lot more lighthearted than Persona 3, in a small town in the rural country of Japan, they investigate a series of murders that happened in their town, which also involves the TV world, which is again a world full of shadows, and through the investigation the world nearly gets destroyed and the investigation team saves the day several times. So yes, as it becomes prudent to do so, I will try and fill in the gaps where it stitches together the stories of Persona 3 and Persona 4 into this narrative. But yes, that's the general summary, and you have to apologize if I'm a bit anxious whilst playing this game, because this is a 2D fighting game. I am by no means comfortable playing 2D fighting games at all. I've done a few practices, I'm not particularly good, I try to avoid button mashing, but this is me you were talking about. Button mashing comes second nature to me. But I have read that Persona 4 Arena is actually a quite accessible fighting game comparative to some of the others. So we should be okay. We should be okay. I'm more playing this for the story, if anything, because it is pretty much half fighting game, half visual novel. So we'll, if I need to drop the difficulty to get through the fighting segments, I will. But we'll start on normal, just because I've got to retain some form of dignity. Okay, so shall we get started? Is there anything else I need to talk about? Oh, yes! Silly voices. Given this is a visual novel game, I will do really daft voices as we play along. If you think it's a bit cringe, then probably not the let's play for you to watch, but I have fun doing it, so here we go. Yes, so like I said, I've done some practices. It's pretty straightforward. You can start really simplistic, but the combos do get quite complex. But the other complicated thing is the story mode. There is this episode P4, which I don't want to press. Because Persona 4 Arena Ultimax is... it's like an addition to, but also a sequel to the original Persona 4 Arena game. So, P4A story mode is the original story mode you got in Persona 4 Arena. And then episode P4 is the sequel to that, so it's a bit disconcerting that they'll put that first, because people will probably press on that and then not have the preceding story. So I'm gonna go through Persona 4 Arena story mode, see what that's all about, and then we'll jump into episode P4. So without further ado, I think we should hit go. We'll start by playing as Yu Narukami. And whether or not I do all the different characters is a different story. Because the way it kind of works is there are repeater paths here where Yu Narukami will go to the end of the game, Yosuke will go to the end of the game. But if the characters are sort of together in the narrative, then it's essentially exactly the same. So I will go with Yu Narukami and then probably another character, and we'll see how far that takes us. Blue. The floor, the ceiling, the furnishings. Everything is blue. Da-ba-dee-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-dee-da. It's quite unlike what I normally see throughout my day. And yet, my heart is mysteriously calm. Yes, this is the Velvet Room from Persona 4. The limousine making its way through the mist and the fog. I recognize the slight rumbling as an engine and realize that I'm in a car. Or rather, someplace else I recognize.
Welcome to the Velvet Room.
Here he is! My main man, Igor! the nose himself. The old man with the bizarre face sitting before me makes an expression that appears to be a smile. Sitting quietly next to the old man is a woman as beautiful and delicate as an eye sculpture. Has to be Margaret, right? You know, one thing I never really paid much attention to in the Persona games is, does Igor sleep? Like, my god, those eyes are just bloodshot as hell. Like, man, I haven't slept in 72,000 years. Goddamn teenagers keep coming into my room and needing help saving the world. It's a poor ego.
Ah, it seems we have a guest with an intriguing destiny. My name is Igor. I am delighted to make your acquaintance.
The Velvet Room. Igor. Even though I'm barely conscious, I remember that this is not the first time I've heard those names. I see. This is a dream. Not necessarily a dream, but you are in a place between mind and matter. Between dreams and realities. This happened in the past. I've been in this room before. If my memory is correct, what he says next is...
This place exists between dream and reality, mind and matter.
Ever a consistent one, Hugo.
It is a room that only those who are bound by a contract may enter. It may be that such a fate awaits you in the near future.
The words I expect to hear fall from the old man's mouth. Surprised that I still remember them. Another me, the one not in the dream, Can't help but smile at that. It means things are about to get spicy again.
Now then, why don't you introduce yourself?
Yeah, you know, one of the things with the Persona games, though, is that... you know the main characters, like the investigation team, they go through all this stuff. How do they ever go back to normal, just like studying as students? Like, we save the world, but no one knows. That's kind of a lot to carry around. I need some therapy. I remember this too. When I said my name here, it forged a contract with them. And so I answer. You, Narukami. I forgot to turn on my my beam. There you go. Not that's going to help much. When I open my eyes, the light is so blinding that I have to squint. For a moment,
right. I was on my way back.
Oh. Ah, man. The soundtrack from Persona 4 just brings so much joy. Like, it's just nostalgia incarnate. I hope you can hear it. Let me know if you need me to turn it up. I'm just aware that the battling in the game can be quite loud and... Yeah, I don't want to... Oh well, when is it? My hair annoys me sometimes when it does this. Like, it's not actually settling properly. You know? Not that I'm particularly vain about my appearance, man. Yeah, should be a bit better. I mutter to myself and look out the window. The sky is somewhat cloudy, unfortunately, but the scenery is as peaceful as always. It seems that I fell asleep on the train headed to the countryside, where I spent the last year, in Inaba. We're going home! Yes! If I recall correctly, when I first came to that town, it was an afternoon just like this. I dozed off in the same way back then, and was summoned to the Velvet Room. That was when Igor said that misfortunes would befall me. And just as he foretold, I was dragged into an outrageous murder mystery. Outrageous would be a understatement. It involved giant floating eyeballs, gods, lots of shadow monsters. Some of our friends turned into giant flaming birds and robots trying to enforce exchanges. That was a weird period of time. That was no ordinary case. The Midnight Channel, shadows and personas, the powers of the heart. I saw things that could scarcely be believed. But I made memories there that can never be replaced as well. We gained the powers of the personas, and we suffered together and made a million social links. I stood with my friends on the investigation team against these misfortunes and fought alongside them. There's no way I could have overcome such ordeals without their help.
I wonder what everyone's been up to.
Oh, you know, school. I believe the time frame, if you're interested in the time frame, is the end of Persona 4, which is the end of the school. I think it's the end of the school year, around March, April time. The protagonist goes back to the city because he only came to Inaba because his parents were off on business or something for a year. So he stayed with his uncle in Inaba. But at the end of the year, went back to where his parents lived in the city. And I believe here, it's the summer break, I think. And he's coming back to spend some time with his friends. After solving the mystery, it was decided that I would leave Inaba since my parents would be returning from overseas around the same time. It's been about 2 months since I last saw them all, as they said goodbye to me at the train station, I had decided to stay at the Dojima residence during Golden Week, so that I could spend the holiday with my friends. Yes, Golden Week, which is actually the namesake for Persona 4 Golden, is essentially a week. I don't know how true it is in Japan, but it's essentially just a week of back-to-back holidays, so Japan gets a week off, effectively. Of course, my uncle was happy to hear this, and his only daughter, Nanako, should be glad to see me too. Nanako! Oh god, man. Nanako. That game had me in the first half with Nanako, I'm not gonna lie.
Oh, damn it. I still haven't picked up Yosuke's gift.
Well, it is something quite particular, I guess. Actually, I'd received a call from Teddy, one of my investigation team friends, this morning. Ah, Teddy. Now, in the original Persona 4, I don't think Teddy was voiced by Sam Riegel, but then Sam Riegel took over in Persona 4 Golden, and this game, I think. We'll know as soon as we hear Teddy. The details of the conversation were a bit troublesome.
Hello? Is this Sensei?
That has to be Sam Riegel, right? I don't know, man, because some voice actors can pull other voices off quite convincingly. For example, I believe in this game, Kanji Tatsumi is voiced by Matthew Mercer. But in the original Persona 4, it was voiced by Troy Baker. It's a bit funny. I hate being so confident and then getting it wrong.
Yeah, what's up?
And of course, you, Narukami, Johnny Young Bosch. My voice is always obvious.
I'm really sorry to bring this up, but I forgot to tell you something very important.
Oh, I forgot the gosh darn bear puns. God damn it, Teddy.
A special request for the souvenirs. I'm sure you'll be bringing your bear's friend.
Teddy, I'm pretty sure you're not supposed to tell people what you want them to bring you as souvenirs. It's Teddy. I don't know, man. I respect it. It's better than getting something you don't want. I already have souvenirs for everyone, but oh well. Sure enough, Teddy was only asking for some snacks that aren't sold in Inaba, so it wasn't much trouble. Oh, I realised that my camera is blocking some of the text. It's only the last word of that line though, so it's kind of okay here. The reason why I'm so low down in comparative to other games is because this is a fighting game. You've got health bars there and up there, so I wanted to make sure that was unblocked. But there was one problem.
Oh, and one more thing. Can I ask you to pick up something for Yosuke too?
I was planning on bringing something for everyone anyway, but go ahead.
Cool! Well, Yosuke's been down in the dumps after his mommy burned his favorite nurse.
Excuse me?
She was what I called scorching hot! Just kidding.
Oh, God! Not Yosuke's magazines.
A nurse?
Aw, oh, come on, Sensei. You know what I'm talking about. His nurse magazine with the chest examinations and the bear behind.
Oh, God.
I see.
How do you respond to that conversation? Oh, yeah. Right.
And you expect me to buy him a replacement?
Of course, silly. People coming to visit are supposed to bring presents.
Here, Yosuke, I bought your centerfold.
All right. Oh, I was planning to head back tomorrow, but since we're meeting up early, I decided to go back today. Can you pass that on to everyone?
Aha! Then the sexy nurses will be arriving even sooner.
Oh, so it's not actually a purchase for Yosuke. It's bloody... Teddy was the probably reason the ruse was foiled. Just leaving them lying around.
It'll be like, Sensei, we have an emergency patient. Yosuke will be so happy. Okay, then. We'll be waiting for you.
Yeah. It was a bit jarring going from Persona 3, which was... It still had its lighthearted moments, but the story was pretty much around the idea of death, and it was very serious. And then Persona 4 would just throw Teddy at you, and he hits you in the face like a freight train. We've had serious discussions about the nature of life and death to... sex puns by a guy in a bear costume. I love Persona. I'm a little worried now. I hope he isn't telling everybody something that would give them the wrong idea. Well, I should just call again once I get there. But in the end...
Nurses, huh?
You and Narukami would have no problem going in and buying pornographic magazines. Like, he would just walk in, put them on the thing and just buy them. like, in the original game... obviously, in this game, they've got to give him more personality because he's named and voiced a lot more than he was in the original game, because Yu's largely the one driving the narrative here. Whereas in the original game, he took more of a nameless protagonist kind of role, where Yu controlled Yu Narukami. So it was kind of... it was kind of a badass, almost sociopathic sort of character. I wasn't able to pick one up for him. How can I put it? I feel bad for Yosuke if I gave him that magazine. And every time he opened it, his friend's face kept popping up in his head. That is a very good point. oh, goodness. And I have to think Yosuke had his pride too. He doesn't need me buying him this stuff. Then again, this is Yosuke we're talking about. I'm sure he'll understand if I explain my reasoning. Probably.
Now pulling into Yaso Inaba. This will be the last stop. Yaso Inaba.
Oh.
End of the line already? Looks like I've been asleep for a lot longer than I thought. Just as that thought came to me, a certain worry crossed my mind. If I had a dream of a velvet room, does that mean I'm going to be dragged into another adventure? I'm not sure if a word adventure for it more is, am I going to get dragged into a traumatic experience? No, I shouldn't think such things. I've already taken down a god. Which was badass. I'm overthinking it. Igor had said, I am delighted to make your acquaintance after all. So it's nothing but a dream. It's quite misleading, since I've had dreams of being summoned into that room ever since. The train begins to slow, and I take that as my cue to gather my belongings from a luggage rack above me. No, that's when we're leaving. When the train comes to a complete stop and the doors open, even the smell of the wind evokes a sense of nostalgia. I think I'm getting a little too sentimental. I step out of a platform with a wry smile. There we go. Make sure you save the game. You don't want to lose all that progress you've just done. There we go. Oh, the train station. I'm standing in front of a train station, but this town is as quiet as it's always been. I realize that the sun has started to set, and the orange sky envelops the world.
Well, what should I do?
Yeah, another thing that's a bit jarring is the antagonist, the culprit behind everything that happened. Well... from the real world side of things in Persona 4, what was a guy called Toru Adachi, who was also voiced by John Young Bosch. So whenever Yu Narukami speaks, you can hear Adachi's voice there as well. So it's a bit jarring that, you know, the main murderer from the original game is the one driving the narrative here. Today is May 2nd. According to the calendar, the latter half of the holidays will begin tomorrow. I told Dojima-san that I was going to arrive today, but it seems he's been too busy with work to come get me. Some things never change, do they? Dojima, who is Narukami's uncle, he was very work-heavy. The reason for him being so work-heavy is that he's a detective in this town. And way before Narukami came into town, his wife got run over by hit and run, and that incident was never solved. So Dojima was always pushing that case at work, and never came home and spent time with family, and particularly Nanako, who's his young daughter. But at the end of the game, it resolved itself that he learned to not let go of the past, but he learned to moderate it, in that he's a detective because he wants to protect his family and his town and not go on a mad vengeance hunt. So he ended up being a bit softer and spending more time with Nanako. Ryotaro Dojima. He's my uncle. I stayed with him last year. He's a detective with Inaba Police, and he's raising his elementary school age daughter, Nanako, by himself. Seems that he was suddenly contacted by a detective from the Metropolitan Police Department regarding last year's case and will have to work late. What happened last year was very serious, so I guess it's not too surprising he's so busy. Well, it was a double murder with a copycat murder as well, so it was very confusing given the supernatural element behind it as well. He shouldn't have worried about it. I recall how apologetic he sounded over the phone and can't help smiling. I told him that I knew the way over from the station, but a backpack with necessities and souvenirs for everyone turns out to be quite a load. It's gonna be a hike. Nanako must be waiting for me alone at the house, so I want to get there as soon as possible too. To be honest, I don't know when the bus will come. Maybe I should just call for a taxi. Just as I'm thinking this...
Huh? Nanako?
Nanako rocks up in a minivan.
I can drive now!
I wouldn't be surprised if Nanako, she's so mature for her age. Like, she looks after the house, she does the laundry, she helps cook once she's supervised, so it's...
I'm gonna take you home now, Oni-chan!
Big bro!
Oh, Nanako! She warms my heart. It is Nanako! There's no way I mistake her.
You came to meet me all on your own?
Why did she come to the station all by herself? True, the Dojima residence is within walking distance, but it couldn't have been easy for her. And actually, given that one of the story points of Persona 4 is Nanako did get kidnapped at one point and thrown into the Midnight Channel, so I'm really impressed at just how mature and how stuff like that just bounces off Nanako, because you think that'll knock your confidence, particularly if trusting people that you're supposed to trust. But no, Nanako is just an absolute warrior. And even though it's still light out right now, it will get dark soon, and the country roads are barely lit. What would she have done if I hadn't been here? I'm about to voice my concerns, but Nanako sounds slightly proud when she says...
Don't worry, Dad knows about it. He gave me money for the bus.
Oh.
He said he couldn't make it, so I came instead. Welcome back, big bro. I wanted to see you so much.
Oh! Adorable meter increase.
Thanks. I'm happy to see you again, too.
If you ever play Persona 4... you have to max out Nanako's social link. Them's the rules. Doesn't matter what else you do. Even if you're speedrunning. If you're speedrunning and you've not maxed out Nanako's social link, then I don't think it counts. I see. She must have wanted to show me that she's grown up too. She is around that age after all. For a moment, I'm surprised that Dejima-san let her do this. But I can kind of imagine what kind of conversation took place. Yeah, we all know who's the boss of the house. Nanako had always been a capable girl. But over the past year, her housekeeping skills have improved greatly. And she's proven herself to be very reliable. She takes the lead in many things within the house. And even Dojima-san can't compete with her sometimes. I can easily imagine that scene in my mind. And it's true that I'm glad someone came to welcome me. I take Nanako's hand and we begin walking side by side.
Well, no sense standing around here. What's in the fridge at home?
Oh god. Don't mess up the cooking.
Lots. Dad and I bought a ton of stuff since you were coming to visit.
If Nanako says so, then he must really must have bought a lot. Dojima-san did say he'd pick up dinner for us, but if that's the case, maybe I should put together something to go with it. I ask Nanako what she wants to eat, and she looks back with a twinkle in her eyes.
Are you gonna cook dinner? Ooh, I wanna help.
Yeah, I don't know what it is, but you Narukami's like a Michelin star chef for some reason. Nanako and I make small talk while we walk through Inaba together for the first time in a little while. Being here like this makes me feel as if I've gone back in time to a year ago. Same. After we get back to the Dejima home, I hurry and unpack my belongings before heading to the kitchen. Nanako helps me out as diligently as she had claimed earlier. The way she mixes the eggs seems more skillful than before. You're such a good girl, Nanako.
Good evening. This is the Evening Journal with news for May 2nd. Our top story is on the domestic airline that was hijacked yesterday.
The TV in the living room echoes through the house. Thinking back on it, it was on quite often in this place. Yeah, we used it for catching all the news about the fog and the weather. And the TV was actually really important in figuring out how much time you had to save each individual in Persona 4. Because when it got foggy and then the fog lifted, that's when whoever was in the TV world got murdered by shadows. When I first came to Inaba, Nanako was practically being raised by the television. Every day is great at your June. Yeah, Nanako just ran around the house singing that. There had been this odd sense of distance between us around that time. She hadn't started calling me Big Bro, and we didn't cook together like we're doing now. It's the little things that bring back memories. Yeah, Nanako was really shy at first. Right as we're about done making dinner, Dojima-san arrives with some deluxe sushi. Nanako quickly gets up and rushes to the door. She seems so happy when her father comes home. Oh god, end the game now. That's all we need. That's all we want. Dojima-san apologizes about the sudden increase in his workload. And then we all sit at the table and begin eating. Being here like this makes me feel like the 2 months I was gone never happened at all. There's a warm atmosphere as if I've always been a part of his family, and have lived here with them for my entire life. Oh, look at the little bears on top of a television. That's so cute. It's like Papa Bear and Baby Bear. I thank both of them from deep in my heart. And after I give them the souvenirs I brought for them, we enjoy chatting with each other as a family. And then we all get sucked into a television. Oh, well, we've got all our stuff on the shelf. The little figurines and a Catherine poster on the calendar. I see you, Catherine. We will be playing you at some point. Although I don't think Tasha will be around to watch that one. Oh dear. Another familiar room. This is a room that was prepared for me on the second floor of the Dejima residence. Nanako had fallen asleep after all the excitement. After carrying her to her room, I tell my uncle that I'll be going to bed early as well, since I have plans. All he said was okay, gesturing toward the second floor. I'm a little perplexed by this, but I have my suspicions. And as I open the door to my old room, it seems I was right. The room is no different than it had been when I was living here. Very consistent. It is, it's pretty much exactly the same. It's exactly the same as it was when I left Inaba. I close the door with a feeling of wistfulness. As I sit down on my sofa and consider my uncle's thoughtfulness, I sigh in exhaustion from a long journey. And then go study at the desk in the corner. I'll be able to see my friends tomorrow. Considering that there are still several days left in this holiday, it may be nice to leave early tomorrow and go visit the shopping district.
It's raining.
Oh god. When it rains at night, the midnight channel comes on. The time is just before midnight. In mere moments, it will be a new day. Oh no. It's gonna happen, isn't it? The telly's gonna turn on. Whenever it rains at night, I end up checking the time. While I spent my last year in Inaba, I was always checking for the midnight channel, which was a popular urban legend here in Inaba. It's a bad habit of mine, even when I'm not here. If you look at a turned off TV at midnight on a rainy night, you'll see your soulmate. Discovering that this room was actually true was the first reason why I became involved in the murder investigation last year. Yeah, I think one of the hazy things about the Persona 4 game is what actually is the Midnight Channel. It makes an attempt at answering it, and it's an answer that I don't really fully understand, but the idea behind the Midnight Channel is it comes on at midnight, and it shows like a silhouette of a person, and if you know them, you can kind of make out who it is, but it's not actually telling you who your soulmate is. It wasn't even... Because the original hypothesis of the investigation team was that it tells you who's going to be targeted for the next murder, which wasn't the case at all. That was just one big red herring set up by Adachi. And it set off a vicious loop of one guy who thought he was saving the people on the television, throwing them into the midnight channel, not knowing that that's what actually kills the person, and then the investigation team going into the TV world, saving them, thus giving the original person from in the telly's idea credit that they didn't die. It's because I threw them in the TV, when it was actually because we pulled them out and saved them. But the silhouette that shows up on the Midnight Channel is nothing to do with that at all. It is essentially just a window into the collective minds of the people of Inaba. So one of the first people that showed up was the TV announcer who was having an affair. And the reason she showed up on there is because she was prevalent in the news. Thus, she was in everyone's mind. Everyone was thinking about her. And that's why she showed up on the Midnight Channel. And so on and so forth. It was generally people that hit the news that people read about. They showed up on the television, the guy threw them in the television to try and save them from being murdered, and we actually saved them from being killed in the midnight, in the TV world. It was all a complete vicious cycle. So that's what the Midnight Channel's actually showing. But the person who actually appears on the Midnight Channel isn't your soulmate. It's the next victim. After discovering this, we all nervously sat before our TVs on rainy nights in order to solve the case.
That brings back some memories. Nothing will show anymore, though.
Well, nothing really appear, though. I suddenly have doubts. Why would I think that? After we solve the case, we all confirm that the Midnight Channel wasn't appearing anymore. The empty screen stays silent. So why?
Just in case.
It's not going to turn on. There's no way. The more I think about it, the more I feel my resolve fading. I peer into the TV screen as if something is drawing me into it. The only thing I see is my reflection in the dark glass of a CRT television. Or so I thought.
Rivals.
Oh boy.
They are friends, yet powerful foes. The desperate fighting program amongst high school students. A new legend is about to start.
May the manliest of all men come on down!
Nobody touches his precious Nanako, the sister complex kingpin of steel, Unagi!
It's only natural.
Wage slave in the boonies by day, hero by night, Captain Ressentiment, Yosuke Hanamura!
Everything that bores me has gotta go!
A spunky dragon with deadly legs. The carnivore who's discarded womanhood, Shie Satoraka!
You need to eat more meat!
Please escort me to the ring, my prince! The unconquerable Snow Black, Yukiko Amagi!
I'll finish you in one strike!
Blooming roses and bulging muscles! The blood-curdling beefcake emperor, Kanji Tatsumi!
Deep into realms of romance!
The body of a child, the brain of a genius, the 2000 IQ killjoy detective, Naoto Shirogane!
Is this an army of idiots?
What is this madness?
The one throne waiting at the end! The P1 Grand Prix, where fierce fights will be fought! The battle begins tonight!
What the hell? The Kingpin Sister Complex! Yeah. Same. But that was funny.
Sister Complex Kingpin of Steel?
It's true! It's backhanded, but it's true. Was that me? Sister Complex Kingpin of Steel. I'm impressed. There's so much wrong with that phrase. I don't know where to begin. No. I shouldn't be thinking about that. Those words aren't the problem here. I hurry to make sure that the TV isn't plugged in. That was the Midnight Channel. What it was actually showing was rather ridiculous. But thinking back, everything the Midnight Channel showed last year didn't make much sense either. I'm suddenly gripped by tension. If the Midnight Channel is appearing again, I have to find out why. I pull out my cell phone and search for Yosuke's number.
Let's see, H. Hanamura Yosuke.
I quickly hit the call button. Does everyone know about this? Is everyone aware that the Midnight Channel is still being broadcasted? Do they know that it's showing us? And that we've been given taglines that can only be described as uncharitable?
Hello, this is Yosuke.
Yosuke?
It's nothing. I just freaked out when you called all of a sudden. Yeah, that's it. What's up?
Oh, is
hey,
it?
When do you want to meet?
Is in denial, isn't he? It's like, it's not just happened. After all we've been through, it's not back. I can tell what's going on just by the sound of his voice. Yosuke knows about what's happened on the Midnight Channel just now. And he's trying to hide that from me. Considering that I've been out of Inaba for a while, I bet he's trying to keep me from worrying about it. There's no need for him to be concerned about that. Then again, I can kind of understand how he feels. I am his friend after all.
And that's not why I was calling. I saw the Midnight Channel. You saw it too, right?
Huh?
I can easily hear Yosuke panicking on the other side of the phone. He's probably surprised that I saw the Midnight Channel, when I shouldn't even be in Inaba right now. He must be thinking that the Midnight Channel is now appearing on a national TV network. Looks like Teddy didn't tell them after
Did
all.
Teddy not tell you? Since we're meeting up early tomorrow, I decided to come today. I figured you wouldn't think I could have seen it, so I gave you a call.
Well, I assumed you weren't here yet, so I didn't want to rely on you.
Yeah, that was another bit. That was like one of the key things behind Yosuke as well, is that you and Narukami was the team lead. He was the protagonist the entire game. But Yosuke had to settle for being, I guess, the assistant manager on that one. And it kind of ate him up that he was relying a bit too much on you for a lot of stuff. He wanted to be more self-reliant. So by the end, he shook that off a bit. But I guess it's still weighing on him a little bit.
You haven't changed. So how about it? You're not going to leave this be, are you, Captain Rasantama?
you jerk.
Why'd you zero in on that part? Did you see how they called you a sister complex kingpin?
Mine's not that bad.
You think? Oh, I ought to tell you, that program's not the only strange thing lately. Teddy, Risei, and Kanji aren't here either. They disappeared.
And you did not tell us? For a moment, I'm at a loss for words. Not only has the Midnight Channel come back on, we've lost contact with three of our friends. I have a bad feeling about this. Can't believe that those two things are unrelated.
All right, we should get together tomorrow like we planned.
Yeah, at the Jeunesse food court.
Oh, back to the secret hideout.
Welcome back, partner.
I'm suddenly reminded that I haven't even greeted Yosuke yet. I finally feel the sense of worry fade a little, and I answer with a smile.
It's good to be here.
No matter what has happened, our friends may be in danger. If that's so, then there's only one thing to do. Speaking of things I have to do.
Oh, right. Sorry to say, I forgot to pick up your souvenir.
What? Our three friends have gone missing. The Midnight Channel's back on. Oh, yeah, by the way. I forgot to pick up your palm mag.
A souvenir? Don't even worry about it, man.
You sure? I thought you were really looking forward to it. Those nurses.
He's just messing with him.
Nurses?
I had a feeling you wouldn't get it if I don't tell him flat out. It's rather hard to bring up, but oh well.
Yeah, Teddy asked me to get it for you. He said you were crushed that they got burned.
Oh, wait, this is all...
I didn't know you were into nurses.
You troll.
Ah, shut up! That's enough! Damn it, you're trying to wind me up, aren't you? Stay home, you jerk.
But I'm already here. Well, I'll see you tomorrow.
He just hangs up. Asshole! At least he seems like he understands about his souvenir. In any case, the preparations have been made. Tomorrow I'll meet with everyone to sort through whatever information we have on this situation. If we have to, we'll go back into that world. It'd be best if this was all just our imaginations. It didn't seem like Naoto was there though. But unfortunately, we know that the Midnight Channel wouldn't have appeared without a reason. I should make sure I'm ready for tomorrow and get some rest. This place is lively as always. I can't tell if that's sarcasm given there's no people on the picture. I look across the food court on Juness's roof for the first time in a while. And listen to the jingle jangle. Even though there aren't many people in Inaba, this place is exceptionally crowded. Again, can't tell if sarcasm. Plus, because it's Golden Week as well, I feel like it's busier than usual. The absurdity of what we're saying here and the just empty Juness food court. I happen to run into Yosuke at the elevators. We briefly greet each other. Guys are weird like that. The closer we are, the more simple our interactions when we get each other face to face. Game. Food. The two of us step out to the food court. We immediately find Yukiko and Chie. They wave back at us past the playground area from the bench they're sitting on.
Good to see you guys again.
Welcome back! We missed you!
Aaron Fitzgerald, I think, plays Chie. Interestingly, in the original Persona 4 game, not the Golden, in Persona 4, I believe Chie was voiced, but I don't know the actress's name, but she was played by a completely different actress who did a good job, and they're an outstanding voice actress, but I think Aaron Fitzgerald fit the bill for Chie a lot better. Just that bubbly, I guess larger than life voice that she brings to the character.
The guest of honor's finally here! You're looking well. Welcome back. Should we...
Huh? Oh, he already knows about the Midnight Channel thing. He's actually the one who called me up about it.
Oh, I see. This has turned into a pretty thrown-together reunion, hasn't it?
Everything we do is thrown together.
But I'm glad you came.
We chat some more while we all sit down. Then Yosuke stands up and clears his throat loudly. He's probably been waiting for the right moment to say something. He hasn't mentioned anything to me, but I can easily guess what he's about to say. We all look towards Yosuke.
Well, it sucks that we can't hang out more before jumping into another mystery, but to celebrate our partner's return, I hereby reinstate the investigation team in response to the Midnight Channel going back on the air last night.
How formal, Yosuke.
Oh, the team is back! Just hearing that name again gets me all fired up. Yeah, let's do this!
Do we still have our godly powers? Like, can I still just go into a TV world and blow myriad truths? Just annihilate, just scorch earth the entire TV world. Right, well, if it's gonna keep coming back, might as well rip it up root and stem.
I don't think the applause is necessary.
Why not? It's been 2 months since we last saw each other, after all. Chie and Yukiko start chuckling when I shrug, and though Yosuke seems saddened at that, he still ends up laughing along as well. It's a relief to see that they're the same as always, but because of that, it makes me even more worried about the friends that aren't here right now. We can't start slacking off. We begin to sort through the information that we know about already.
Well, let's get cracking. I mean, this is no laughing matter. No one's heard from Teddy, Kanji, or Rise. Just those three, right?
Yeah. Oh, I got a hold of Naoto-kun, but I didn't tell her about this stuff. She told me she couldn't make it today because of her job, so I didn't want to worry her.
Yeah. Well, although she would probably drop everything if you told her the Midnight Channel's back on.
She seemed pretty bummed that she couldn't be here too.
If she has a reason for not being here, and we can still contact her, then Naruto should be fine. That leaves Teddy, Rise, and Kanji. Not hearing back from them after an entire day has passed isn't normal at all. The relationship between their sudden disappearances and the reappearance of a Midnight Channel last night disturbs me. Oh yes, and just a brief recap on Naruto. Naruto isn't your normal run-of-the-mill high school student. She's actually an ace detective, so she consults with a police department on particularly difficult cases, which is why her job takes her away a lot. And I think she's from Inaba, but she works for, I'm gathering, the Tokyo Police Department or whatever the Metropolitan Department is. As well, so she's not always in Inaba. She was brought in during Persona 4 to help with the investigation into the murders which the police in Inaba couldn't solve. Which, they couldn't really solve because of the supernatural element, and that the true murderer was one of their own interfering with the investigation. So there was that element. But now to being a consultant, kind of takes different angles. She pretty quickly sussed out that we were involved in the case, and sussed out the supernatural element of it pretty quickly, but found it hard to prove, so ended up using herself as bait, and she naturally got thrown into the television, and we saved her, and that's how she became part of our investigation team.
Yeah. Going by the pattern from last year, it wouldn't be that clear until after the victim entered the TV.
That's one confusing element of it. Why the midnight channel went clear when someone got thrown into the TV is a bit of a mystery, because at that point it's not showing what the people of Inaba want to see. It's actually showing the person's shadow that got thrown in go absolutely havoc. And the idea there being that when someone gets thrown into the TV, the manifestation of their hidden feelings and thoughts and emotions makes itself known by essentially becoming a copy of that person, but with all their emotions running havoc. So Yukiko lashing out that she feels trapped in Inaba and she hates working at the inn. Yosuke that... he's only in it for the fun. He's just bored of being in Inaba and he wants something to do, and so on and so forth.
Hey, isn't this the first time a big group of people was shown together? Plus, we're still here. Why us anyway? And what's up with those insulting descriptions?
GA's was pretty harsh, I must admit. GA seems pretty angry about it. Many of the locals know about the rumor of the Midnight Channel. In other words, this troubling broadcast has already been seen by who knows how many people. From what I've been told, the moment Chie tried to ask another student about the Midnight Channel, the other girl ran away with a look of fear on her face. It's no surprise that Chie would be angry. But in the end...
What bothers me most is Teddy. He was acting like the host of that show.
Yeah, we can't find him.
This smells fishy. Then again, I doubt he would play a prank like this for no reason.
No, I mean, Teddy loves his pranks, but I don't think he'd go that far.
I guess we'll just have to go inside the TV and find out what's going on.
That's right. Go inside the TV. Out of everything, that was the element that shook our common sense the most out of everything we experienced last year. Actually, the murders in last year's events happened in another world inside the television. This world is filled with monsters called shadows that are born from people's hearts. Because my friends and I gained personas, the power to defeat these shadows, we were able to enter the TV screens and fight them.
Won't we be stuck in there without Teddy to give us an exit?
That's true, Teddy was our exit. But even we Persona users would find it extremely difficult to leave that world on our own. In order to come back, we need the exit TV that our friend Teddy was capable of creating.
Not so. I've had Teddy keep the exit TV out on that side.
Look at you, all prepared.
I mean, think about it. What if we were half asleep and fell into a TV when Teddy wasn't over there? Isn't that a scary thought?
Like anyone would be that clumsy.
That's exactly how we ended up in that scenario in the first place.
Anyway, it sounds like it's safe for us to go investigate then.
No matter what the reason, it's reassuring to know that we have an exit strategy ready for us. To be honest, I almost fell into it the first time it appeared in my room, after all.
Yeah, there's no doubt that something's going on in there. Is everyone ready?
We're all good to go. To tell the truth, I had a hunch that this was going to happen.
We all share a look to confirm our intentions. All of them nod back. I can see the seriousness in their eyes. Even though there was a 2-month gap since I last saw them, they still continue to put their trust in me. I feel a slight sense of pride as I stand up from the bench. The large screen TV in the electronics department is directly below the food court. That was the entrance we always used last year. All right, we're doing this.
It's a holiday, so the store's full of people.
I feel like things are picking up around town.
I feel you, man. Oh, it was the social link from before. Eri, I think her name was, something like that.
I'm a little nervous.
Get ready! Huh? The customers are going away! Let's go!
Yeah. Oh boy. It's like a D&D plan. It seems like a good idea until it goes tits up and the tillies aren't actually there. I hear a voice. It's a woman's voice. It sounds familiar to me. This voice is...
Welcome to the Velvet Room.
Oh, Margaret. Hello! I don't sense that distinctive floating feeling that I usually have when I enter the TV world. When I concentrate, I realize that I must be sitting in a chair. The moment I open my eyes, I see vibrant blue. The Velvet Room. I visited this place an untold number of times last year, and once more in my dreams yesterday. I never thought I would return to this place.
Huh? It's not a dream this time? What's going on? Didn't my contract end already?
Igor, who usually sits front and center, is nowhere to be seen. The one to greet me is the woman with silver hair, Margaret. Could this be a personal summoning then? That happened a few times last year too. Yeah, Margaret's social link you progressed by fusing personas together and showing her personas with specific skills. That was an interesting social link. Margaret's smiles fade as if she senses my suspicions.
This room is tied to your fate. Nothing that occurs here is meaningless. Though you reached an end to one journey, you now find yourself here again. This shows that you will once again be faced with a question.
A question? And something really is going on?
Another mystery has appeared, and we are about to be dragged into it again. Could that be what she means?
From here on, what befalls you will upset your status quo. It is true that you've opened the door once already, but all things change. Nothing ever remains the same.
This is very true.
What you gained before will change over time as well. You will have to face them once again.
Face them?
The first thing that Margaret's words stir up in my mind is the sight of my friends' smiling faces. Is that going to change? No, that can't be true. And face them again? That's impossible. Once I wake up and leave this room, I should still be with my friends. There's no need to jump to conclusions. But Margaret appears to have anticipated my thoughts and smiles while narrowing her eyes.
Show me how you will proceed down the path that awaits beyond the door you've opened.
My vision wavers, and the blue light before me vanishes quickly. Wait. I still need to know what you mean by those words. There we go, and I am going to go away, take a quick break, since things seem to be getting a bit exciting. Alrighty, so... Right, we have been thrust into another mystery. So we'll see where this takes us once I get back in just a few minutes.